Friends, welcome to this YouTube channel, and today we are going to discuss a small topic, the organic evolution unit. The topic is the theories of origin of life. The theories of origin of life. Let us get started. The contents of today's lesson are introduction, early concepts of origin of life, the theory of chemical and biological origin of life as explained by A.I. O'Parin and J.B.S. Haldane. Friends, you may be knowing the definition of organic evolution. Organic evolution is a branch of biology that deals with the origin of life and the diversity of organisms on this earth. The diversity of organisms on this earth occurred through the ages. Several theories propose that the genetic allelic frequencies, the modifications or the change of equilibria of the genetic allelic frequencies, is actually causing the evolution process. So, organic evolution is a branch of biology, deals with the origin of life and the continuous changes of one species, genetic changes of one species to another species. The continuous genetic adaptations that a species acquired through the ages is said to be an organic evolution. And because of a set of continuous genetic adaptations, one species is gradually shifted to another species over a course of time. Okay. Organic evolution, the word coined by Herbert Spencer, a very famous quotation given by Duke Chomsky is that nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. Friends, so you cannot understand biology if you don't know the process of evolution. After having learnt about evolution, if you are studying or if you are going through any part of zoology or biology, it can be understood perfectly. You take, for example, when we are studying the nervous system of frog, and when we compare it with a human being, then only the nervous system of frog can be understood very clearly, because human nervous system has undergone several evolutionary changes. So, whatever topic that you are studying in genetics, or you are studying in zoology or in biology or in physiology, you need to have some concept of evolution. So, let me repeat, nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. Earlier, so many scientists or so many people thought that evolution is not actually a process, because a supernatural power or supernatural force created the entire diversity what we are observing on this earth. So that's why no question of evolution, no question of organic evolution arose at that time. So all people believed that some kind of force created the entire living organisms. But science does not accept all these things. The first scientist who is recognized to be the first person to have proposed an organized theory to explain the evolutionary process was Jean-Baptiste de Lamarck. Jean-Baptiste de Lamarck, he explained his Lamarckism in a simple and most convincing manner. He was the first person to explain the entire process of evolution, according to him, in a very simple process with only the three principles. Of course, it is not true for all the cases. It faced a lot of criticism, and it paved the way for explanation of other theories by Charles Darwin and other scientists. Charles Darwin, while traveling by HMS Beagle and visited Galapagos Islands, and happened to observe some very important species called Darwin finches. So, based on that, he proposed another theory. That theory is called natural selection. So, his work, The Origin of Species, explains and touches all parts of evolution, the courses of evolution. Of course, Charles Darwin theory, natural selection, also faced certain criticism. Okay, it is improvised later by his disciples or his students. By the same time when Charles Darwin explained the origin of species, His contemporary scientist Alfred Russel Wallace also explained the same natural selection theory. So his work was on the tendency of varieties to depart from their original types. Both the theories are having the same phenomenon, that nature is going to offer some selecting force. So whichever organism is good or having useful variety, that can be selected according to this. Okay. So both of these two scientists proposed natural selection, but Darwin could produce more evidences than Alfred Russel Wallace could. So later, the followers of Darwin, let's say neo-Darwinists, proposed several other theories in support of Darwinism. The mutation theory was proposed by Hugo de Vries, and allelic frequencies changing and equilibrium are explained by Hardy and Weinberg, Huxley, Haeckel, Simpson, Fisher, Sewall Wright, and Mayer explained the post-Darwinism, that is modern synthetic theory of evolution. So evolution, organic evolution, is a very, very important topic to be discussed here. Early concepts of origin of life. As I mentioned earlier, that most of the people by that time believed that supernatural force created all organism at once. The entire diversity what we are observing today on Earth was also present once upon a time when creation occurred. God created the entire living organisms according to one theory that is known as special creation theory. The special creation theory was propagated by several priests. Father Soares propagated it. And according to this theory, supernatural power or supernatural force by name God created the entire living organism. After creating the universe, after creating Earth, he created plants, flora, and animals, fauna, all of a sudden at a time. Okay. But this theory does not stand against the science. So we don't believe in this theory because it doesn't produce proper evidences. The next concept of origin of life by Arrhenius was cosmozoic theory, which is also known as panspermia. Cosmozoic theory or panspermia explains, according to this theory, it opines that there are resistant spores even spread in the entire space. These resistant spores, which are called cosmozoa, reached the surface of the earth and produced life. And this theory is not showing any clear-cut evidences. And still, it is an ongoing process of researching whether there is any extraterrestrial life in the form of spores or in the form of any organisms. It's going on. So that's why no proper evidence to believe at this time about this theory. So cosmozoic theory explains that life is spread all over the cosmos in the form of small resistant spores. These small resistant spores reached the surface of Earth and produced what we are observing, the present day life. Okay, the next concept is abiogenesis. Abiogenesis is also known as spontaneous generation theory. It was propagated by Aristotle, Thales, Wilhelmert. According to this theory, life can be generated at any time in any manner. And life can be generated from non-living material like food, like decaying or rotting substance, like manure, okay, like dew, or any other substance which is having some food source. So Aristotle explained that the mud of Nile River mud is going to produce frogs and certain fishes. But this theory is having no evidence. What Aristotle thought, that frogs and some of the fishes originated from the mud of Nile is not origin actually, but because of the dormancy conditions of frog and the fishes, which were embedded completely in the mud, came out of mud after when season came. So abiogenesis theory is not accepted, because later another scientist by name Louis Pasteur disproved abiogenesis. And he stated that life seems to be coming, or life seems to be originating from food, but it is not actually originating from food, because some of the insects are laying invisible eggs or invisible spores on the food material. Those eggs gradually grow and develop into organisms. It is because of the mother insect that is laying eggs over the food material, and those eggs are developing in the form of organisms. Okay, when the food was properly covered with some mesh, okay, life started originating, life started coming out of the mesh, not from the food. And it is very clearly understood that because of food, some of the eggs which were already deposited over them, over that food, got developed and appeared as the living organism. So, abiogenesis theory is not accepted. Louis Pasteur proposed biogenesis theory. Biogenesis theory states that life begets life. Any living organism is being formed from the pre-existing living organism only. But this theory is having no evolutionary significance, because life begets life. Okay, but how the first life has come, that's the question. Okay, so another scientist, Louis Pasteur disproved abiogenesis theory by conducting an experiment with the swan neck flask experiment. Okay, so when he used this swan neck and placed some food material inside the flask and allowed it to contact with the air with a small, what is that called, tube-like structure, that is called the neck of a swan neck flask. But even after some time, the food material which is there stored inside the swan neck flask did not, decay. So, as a result of that, it is very, very clear that life cannot be originated from the decaying matter. And next, Georges Cuvier proposed another theory, that is another concept, the theory of catastrophism. Catastrophe is a natural calamity. All of a sudden, floods may occur. All of a sudden, earthquakes may occur, and severe drought conditions and several other volcanic eruptions, and these are all catastrophes. The entire earth subjected to a very big change. Of course, there may be a climate change, a very, very big intolerable change occurs in the form of a catastrophe or calamity, and during that already existing life will be died or will be removed, and new life will come to take its origin. This is the theory, but it doesn't have proper evidence. Okay, Earth was subjected to periodic catastrophes. The existing organisms will be perished and new ones are created according to this theory, but this theory has no proper evidences. So, friends, these are the earlier concepts of origin of life: special creation theory, cosmozoic theory, abiogenesis, biogenesis, and catastrophism theory. And how actually life originated? What is the most advanced theory to explain the origin of life? A.I. Oparin of Russia and J.B.S. Alden of England proposed a theory. This theory is known as theory of chemical and biological origin of life. This theory is the most advanced theory, and this theory got certain evidences, and this theory got certain experimental verification, and it is proved to be the most advanced theory at present times. Oparin and Haldane proposed that prehistoric Earth is having a different atmosphere when we compare to that with the present day atmosphere. Because of those, the conditions prevailed at that time might have favored the origin of life. Okay, all other concepts what we were discussed earlier, especially the special creation theory, explains that there is no beginning and no end to the life. But here A.I. Oparin stated that yes, there had a beginning for life on Earth. So life might have formed on Earth by certain chemical changes, by certain chemical reactions. Primitive organisms evolved spontaneously from the inorganic substances during the primitive Earth conditions. I mentioned once again that the primitive Earth conditions are not like the conditions what we are presently observing. The present observing Earth atmosphere is rich in oxygen, but the primitive Earth atmosphere was not having any oxygen. Okay, and present day atmosphere and our surroundings is having amicable temperature, but at that time the temperature was very, very high. It was very hot on the surface of Earth, and the physical forces what we are observing are very different to different at that time. The physical forces like lightning, the physical force, ultraviolet radiation, volcanic activities, and all continuous raining, and all these might have created a kind of atmosphere, so which might have generated the life from the chemical substances. Hence, this is called the chemical and biological origin of life. So, our biology, if you want to understand, our biology is nothing but undergoing several chemical reactions, several biochemical, let us say biochemical reactions. So, life is, what is that, a continuous summation of several chemical reactions. So, how the chemicals which are needed for maintaining our metabolism are formed and how they are maintaining, let us discuss in two ways. One is the chemical origin, and the second one is the biological origin. Let's see. So, I repeat, primitive organisms evolved spontaneously from the inorganic substances during the primitive Earth conditions. Certain physical forces like lightning, ultraviolet radiation, volcanic activities might have favored the origin of life by that time. So, first chemicals are formed and later biological phenomena occurred. Earth and entire the universe along with Earth might have formed 4.5 billion years ago. And when Earth was formed, the surface temperature of Earth was about 5000 to 6000 degrees centigrade. It was very, very hot. Almost all chemicals what are there forming the Earth were in the form of gaseous state. And these hot gases around the Earth, which are forming the Earth, slowly cooled down over millions of years. Not one single year, over millions of years. So, Earth gradually cooled down. As the Earth was cooling down, the gaseous gradually become liquids, and liquids gradually became solids. And still, the core of Earth, the mantle of Earth, were very, very hot. In the core region, we observe, actually according to the certain theories, it is around 5000 degrees to 6000 degrees still prevailing at the core. So, the same temperature was prevailing on the surface of Earth 4.5 billion years ago. And it gradually cooled down over millions of years. The lighter elements, Earth is made up of all elements, lighter elements like hydrogen, helium, nitrogen, carbon, they flowed onto the surface and formed a gaseous envelope called atmosphere. Let me repeat. The lighter elements like hydrogen, helium, nitrogen, carbon, so all these lighter elements flowed onto the surface and created a gaseous envelope that is called atmosphere. Friends, it is very important to note that by the time there was no free oxygen. Oxygen was present in the form of oxides. Oxygen was present in the form of water. Okay, in the form of oxides, in the form of water, oxygen was available. No free oxygen was available by that time. Actually, free oxygen was added to the atmosphere by plants in an activity called photosynthetic activity. There was no life at that time. So, no photosynthetic activity, no oxygen, free oxygen. Oxygen was present, but not in the free form, but in oxide form. Okay. because oxygen was absent and more hydrogen is there, was there in that atmosphere, the atmosphere is said to be very reducing atmosphere. Okay, and many elements what are there in the reducing atmosphere might have combined with one another. Say hydrogen, nitrogen combined to form ammonia, hydrogen, carbon combined to form, reacted to form methane. Likewise, gradually ammonia is added to the atmosphere, primitive earth atmosphere, and methane was gradually added to the primitive earth atmosphere. So these changes might have happened over millions of years. And the water vapor gradually condensed. Okay, water was there in water vapor, in the form of water vapor, and water vapor gradually condensed in the form of drops, droplets, and it was raining for continuous years. And because of continuous raining, the rain water ran over the land and collected all the minerals by the, what is that called, erosion of all the stones and other things. All the minerals are collected and water went downstream and mingled or joined all the streams, joined to form oceans. So oceans collected all the minerals from different parts of the surface of the earth. Now the ocean is having many minerals and it was boiling like a soup because of more energy is there available in the form of heat, and many chemicals are there, and radiation we are receiving, ultraviolet radiation, and because of volcanic eruptions, so certain other chemicals are added. And because of all these events that occurred over millions of years might have caused the formation of certain chemicals which are needed for the biology. Okay, highly reacted radical like CH minus and CH2 minus might have formed, and these radicals reacted, or these radicals are stimulating or catalyzing all other chemicals to form a variety of hydrocarbons, and these variety of hydrocarbons reacted with ammonia and reacted with water. As a result of reactions between the hydrocarbons, ammonia and water, in the presence of radicals, in the presence of all these energetic molecules, there may be a condensation, there may be an oxidation, there may be a polymerization, and there may be what is that called a reduction reactions. Condensation, oxidation, reduction and polymerization reactions might have occurred to form the macromolecules of life. Okay, so all these reactions might have resulted in the formation of sugars, amino acids, fatty acids, purines, pyrimidines. Later all these reacted to form nucleosides, nucleotides. Okay, all these are formed in boiling soup in the oceanic regions because the soup is having all minerals. Okay, so J.B.S. Haldane described this soup as hot dilute soup. In hot dilute soup, all the chemicals are formed. What are the chemicals? Sugars, simple sugars, amino acids, fatty acids, purines, pyrimidines. And later, somewhat complicated molecules are formed by all these reactions. The complicated one or complex ones are nucleosides, nucleotides. Later, sugars combine to form polysaccharides, amino acids join to form proteins, fatty acids to fats, and nucleotides to, what is that called, nucleic acids, nucleoproteins. These are all the biochemicals. So, first chemical origin occurred. Chemicals needed for the life are created first or formed first, and later biological organisms, living organisms like structures formed according to this theory. And in this slide we have seen how the chemicals, sugars, amino acids, fatty acids, like chemicals are formed. Let's see the next part of this theory, that is biological origin of life. So all the chemicals, biomolecules, rather we say, the biomolecules like sugars, amino acids, fatty acids are having aggregation property. So they are aggregating at a particular place. And these are called colloidal aggregates. The colloidal aggregates are named as coeservatives. And in these coeservatives, there are certain free genes. Free genes are nothing but DNA molecules and RNA molecules. The free genes, along with the fatty acids, along with the proteins, along with the polysaccharides, are aggregated at a particular place in a colloidal solution. So these colloidal aggregates are actually called coeservatives. The coeservatives may be present in hot areas, and other small microsomes like structures may be present in cold areas. Okay, so these coeservatives are having certain properties. What are those properties? So intermolecular attractions. Because of intermolecular attractions, so they are attracting some chemicals, okay, from outside. As outside chemicals are coming inside, gradually they are growing. Okay, when the size is grown, some repulsive forces might have occurred there to divide this larger aggregate into two smaller aggregates. And this is looking just like a binary fission, a process of binary fission. So they are having intermolecular reactions. These intermolecular reactions, let us compare with metabolism. And as a result of that, some attractions, okay, growing in size, and due to repulsive forces, they are dividing. Likewise, the coeservatives are gradually spreading over that particular prebiotic soup in hot areas. Life might have formed in colder areas also, in the form of small microspheres. Okay, so these microspheres and those coeservatives, by somehow mechanism, they gradually behaving like the early living organisms. The origin of early living organisms, you see, there are free genes. What are free genes? Free genes are nothing but DNA. The DNA molecules are replicating themselves. The free genes are always replicating themselves. And during the replication process, some errors occurred. And because of the errors, one DNA changed into other DNA. One molecule changed into another, one free gene changed into another free gene. And when there is continuous supply of energy, when there are free genes, when there is continuous supply of energy, and when during the replications, when some errors occurred and the errors favored to form new varieties of DNAs, new varieties of RNAs, all these phenomena might have occurred in the early life 3.5 billion years ago. Okay, as a result of that, organisms with the cellular structure might have formed. The first formed living organisms are heterotrophs. What are heterotrophs? Heterotrophs are those organisms which are gathering food from outside. So first formed living organisms are like anaerobic heterotrophs. The anaerobic heterotrophs, the source of energy production for anaerobic heterotrophs is fermentation. They may be having one or two DNA molecules, and they are almost all looking like prokaryotes, prokaryotic heterotrophs. The source of energy production is fermentation. Gradually, these anaerobic heterotrophs over a course of time might have changed as chemoautotrophs. Chemoautotrophs are nothing but iron or sulfur bacteria, and they can thrive in high temperatures nearby volcanic eruptions, and they are utilizing the energy source from heat, and they are synthesizing their own chemicals by utilizing the energy. Okay, as they are synthesizing their chemicals like sugars, like proteins, they are called autotrophs. Autotrophs. But what energy they are using? They are using chemical energy. Okay, they are using chemical energy. That's why they are called chemoautotrophs. Okay, the chemoautotrophs later later or in some other reasons. We don't know whether these are actually evolved or all these have occurred over different places on Earth. So at some places, let us say, these organisms evolved a kind of light fixing pigment, and this is known as bacterial chlorophyll. The bacterial chlorophyll might have formed, and that might have resulted in the formation of purple or green sulfur bacteria. The purple and green sulfur bacteria is fixing carbon and hydrogen with the energy grabbed from sunlight. But by this method, when carbon fixation occurred, but by this method, no oxygen was released. Hence, these are called anoxygenic autotrophs, anoxygenic photoautotrophs, because they are utilizing light energy. But oxygen was not liberating by these organisms. So, these are called anoxygenic photoautotrophs. And after this, another bacteria evolved true chlorophyll molecule. The true chlorophyll molecule is grabbing the energy of sunlight, solar energy, and fixing the carbon and hydrogen to form the carbohydrate, and by this time it is liberating oxygen to the atmosphere by the photolysis of water. Earlier organism sulfur bacteria, so they are metabolizing or they are utilizing the energy by cutting the hydrogen sulfur bonds in hydrogen sulfide. They are releasing sulfur, hence they are called sulfur bacteria. Okay, but here they are cutting the bond, they are breaking the bond between hydrogen and oxygen in water. As a result of that, hydrogen is taken in and oxygen is liberated. By this way, oxygen is gradually added to the atmosphere, and present day we are observing 21% of oxygen in our atmosphere because of photosynthetic activity, oxygenic photosynthetic activity. Photosynthetic activity is two types, anoxygenic, oxygenic. Okay, anoxygenic photosynthesis is done by bacterial chlorophyll, and oxygenic is done by true chlorophyll, which is present in blue-green alga and all other plants, present plants. So, the reducing atmosphere gradually shifted towards oxidizing atmosphere by this time. Okay, by several million years ago, this has occurred, and gradually the prokaryotes accommodated some bacteria like another prokaryotes, and those prokaryotic bacteria might be doing the role of our mitochondria, like plastids. The plastids and mitochondria, the theories explain that these are the symbiotic bacteria once entered in a prokaryotic cell to make the prokaryotic cell a eukaryotic cell. Okay, so eukaryotes evolved by accommodating or symbioting with certain bacteria which are gradually settled in our cell to be the mitochondria and plastids. And this theory explains the origin of life. So first, anaerobic heterotrophs gradually shifted to chemoautotrophs, and chemoautotrophs gradually later might have become what is that called bacterial chlorophyll organisms like anoxygenic bacteria, and later oxygenic prokaryotes, and later by accommodating mitochondria and the chloroplastid, the prokaryotic cell might have evolved into eukaryote, and from the protistans gradually plant and animals might have evolved over a course of time. And for this theory, Stanley Miller and Harold Urey made an experimental setup and conducted the experiment by giving several simulations. Simulation of heat, okay, in the form of lighting a candle like that. So they have given the simulation of heat and the simulation of ultraviolet rays by giving some electric flashes, and condensing, simulation of cooling, and when this experiment is run for some time, they observed the formation of simple sugars, simple amino acids. So by this, there is an evidence for this theory. So 3.5 billion years ago on our Earth, life had a beginning. Life had a beginning. First, the chemicals are formed needed for the life. Later, the living organisms are formed from these chemicals. Okay? Right. Friends, hope you have understood this, the theories related to origin of life and the concepts related to the origin of life. Thank you. Thank you for watching this lesson.